Back to Sao Paulo. It's the qualifying hour to decide the starting grid for tomorrow's Brazilian Grand Prix. We're 3 hours behind you in Britain. It's nearly 1 o'clock here. Good afternoon to Martin Brundle once again, and hello to Murray Walker.
Hi, Jim. Good afternoon, everybody. Well, it's a very different track to Melbourne, Australia, here at Interlagos in Brazil, Sao Paulo. But trick braking system or not, McLaren are still very much in charge of proceedings. Despite not being allowed to use their system yesterday or today, they, both Mika Häkkinen and David Coulthard, were an incredible 1.2 seconds faster than the next fastest man, Heinz-Harald Frentzen, this morning. They went round in a time which, like Australia, if they can do it tomorrow in comparison to the opposition, will enable them to lap everybody. So that proves something. It proves that the braking system is contributing something, but not as much as the opposition suspected. As you look at Mika Salo, like everybody else, getting ready to go out for this final 60 minutes, and it's an altitude circuit, Martin.
Yes, it is. It's at 2,400 feet, this circuit, and obviously that gives the cars, the engines, the aerodynamics, and the drivers something like 6% less air. Everything has to work that little bit harder here, but at least then there's less drag, but there's less power. And then there is less cooling, but the main thing for the drivers is because they get less air in their lungs to be able to drive this very, very physical racetrack.
It's hot and it's humid at Interlagos in Brazil, near the second largest city in the world, Sao Paulo. The air temperature is 27 degrees, the track temperature is getting on for 40 degrees, and it's a very, very demanding, bumpy circuit. The McLarens, who did so well in Australia, have been riding those bumps magnificently here at Interlagos. This morning, in the final session prior to this qualifying period, Mika Häkkinen was just 1/10 of a second faster than his teammate David Coulthard, and they were 1.2 seconds faster than Heinz-Harald Frentzen, with Gianni Fisichella, the Italian in the Benetton, fourth fastest, ahead of Ralf Schumacher, who has seen off Damon Hill yesterday and today. Ralf Schumacher in the Jordan Mugen, and Alexander Wurz in the second Benetton. So apart from the McLarens, Martin, the Benettons, which are also using Bridgestone tyres, are looking very good.
Yes, they are. The Bridgestones appear to work well around this circuit. Remember, this is Bridgestone's second year in Formula 1, so they have all of the data. When they came here last year, they really didn't know what to expect. They can take a chunk of the tarmac away with them and analyse it and make a best guess of how their tyres would work last year. This year, they have all of that data, and it's working well on the McLarens and on the Benettons. But at least Frentzen and Schumacher in the Jordan, giving them a bit of a hurry up. Michael Schumacher driving the wheels off the Ferrari as ever is also there or thereabouts. And Jordan are expecting, I think, a much better qualifying session today than in Melbourne. Damon Hill did a very, very good time in Barcelona last week. Four changes they made to the car, a couple of them mechanical, a couple of them aerodynamic. They tried this new wider front Goodyear tyre. And I think they're coming here cautiously optimistic, but they're still in no way threatening the pace of that McLaren.
Well, there's Ralf Schumacher in the background, fifth fastest this morning, third fastest yesterday in the Jordan Mugen. That's the man to watch, David Coulthard, who moved over and let Mika Häkkinen through to win the Australian Grand Prix. And James Allen has got some news for us from the pit lane.
And sensational news it is, Murray. I've just heard that Mika Häkkinen, Eddie Irvine, Damon Hill, Alexander Wurz, Olivier Panis and Pedro Diniz did not back off this morning under a waved yellow flag during the practice. Remember, that's what happened to Villeneuve in Suzuka last year. The rules have changed now, however, and the stewards can now remove the fastest time from the day from those drivers, which of course today involves qualifying. So that's very good news for David Coulthard, because it looks as though if Mika Häkkinen gets in front of him, he will still be on pole position. Quite sensational. Martin, what do you make of all that?
Well, I think it's a good move. There's been so many cars spinning off this morning, as we've already said, and the corner workers go out onto the racetrack. There's breakdown vehicles, four-wheel drive vehicles all over the place, and the drivers must lift off. You're always under pressure to do the fastest lap, but when you get to that kind of scene, you have to get out of the throttle pedal, and clearly those drivers have not been paying attention to what happened to Villeneuve over in Japan, And that's an interesting punishment. I think that's a punishment where they get an immediate, it has an immediate effect. I think it's nicely, that'll work out quite nicely, actually.
James, just give us those names again. You reeled them off. Mika Häkkinen.
I'm sorry, Murray. I was a bit too quick for everybody, wasn't it? It's Häkkinen,
yeah.
Irvine in the Ferrari, Damon Hill, unfortunately, Alexander Wurz, who was very quick this morning as well, Panis and Diniz. But obviously the big issue there is Häkkinen. And the stewards, as I say, do have the right to take his fastest time away, which fantastic news for David Coulthard if that is the case. Meanwhile, Villeneuve is not going to use his race car. He crashed it very badly this morning, as Martin mentioned earlier, and he will be in the spare car for the entire qualifying session. The race car may be fixable for tomorrow, but at the moment it doesn't look like it.
Well, the Prost is on the racetrack, as you can see. But of course, they will. I think they'll have four runs today, 12 laps in total, four sets of tyres available to them. That's an out, a flying lap, and an in lap. So if they have to give up one of those four, it's not the end of the world, but it's still going to be, as you rightly say, James, their fastest lap they have to give up. As we watch truly on that ever-critical infield section here, this is where all the time is. This is where Häkkinen was quicker than Coulthard this morning, and this is where your whole qualifying lap is made or lost. The other bits are faster, more spectacular, more fun to drive, but you spend a lot more relative time in the slow corners, in the first and second gear corners, and you can win so much by getting off the brake pedal 3 or 4 metres earlier, getting on the throttle pedal gently, but firmly on the exit. Just 2 or 3 metres makes all the difference, and it's a tenth or two. And he goes over the line to start that first flying lap.
And into the Senna S, which he approaches at about 190 miles an hour. The left, the right, that leads into the Curva do Sol, this third gear, 135 miles an hour corner, building up to 180 miles an hour to Lake Descent. Water on the left, truly can't see it, of course. Now he keeps bearing left, building up to about 130 miles an hour, and then about 170 miles an hour before he backs off for the Ferradura, the horseshoe, which is a third gear bend, which he's approaching now. And from the horseshoe, he bears right, drops downhill. There's a lot of gradient on this circuit.
Yeah, ran wide there. Didn't get the car into the curbs on the right-hander. That will have cost him badly. And truly, he had a very poor run, I think, through the last Grand Prix, through Melbourne weekend. He needs a strong performance this weekend, and this first lap's not going to work too well for him. Murray, pick it up. Where is he now?
Well, he's approaching the Juncal. That's where Ayrton Senna went off at his last Brazilian Grand Prix when he was trying to close with Michael Schumacher in the Benetton. And this is the gradient. I've walked round this circuit, and it's a heck of a climb, I can tell you, from turn 12 up to the finish, turn 15 and 10. They're going into the Senna S again, and Jarno Trulli, of course, is the fastest so far. 1:20.6, which is over a second slower than he went this morning. It is a bit hotter now.
It's a little bit hotter, but he did lose the time on that small right-hander, Pinarino, and I think that's some 3 seconds away from where pole position is going to be.
Just a quick identification point. The Prosts are very difficult to tell apart. You can tell Trulli by the fact that he's got a white flash on the front wings. There's the fastest man in Australia, the winner in Australia, the fastest man so far here at Interlagos, Brazil. Mika Häkkinen sitting impassively in the McLaren Mercedes as Ralf Schumacher, who was fifth fastest this morning. I expect him to go ahead of Jarno Trulli because of that mistake that Trulli made, and indeed he has. Ralf Schumacher, Michael's brother, is 0.3 seconds faster than Jarno Trulli. The rules of the game are the same here as everywhere else. They're allowed 12 laps. They'll probably have four sessions, each of 3 laps. They're allowed 40 tyres for the whole meeting. And that spinner down there is Takagi.
It's
Ricardo Rossi, my apologies. And he's been in real trouble, the Brazilian. He went off on the out lap yesterday and took the right-hand side off the Tyrrell. He had a problem this morning. And look at him here. The one place that he would want to do better than anywhere else is Interlagos. He comes from Sao Paulo, and he's gone off in the Senna S, of all places, in front of thousands of his countrymen.
Yes, there's some days Rosset couldn't drive a nail into a piece of wood, and this looks like one of them. He's parked it in the middle of the Senna S, as you rightly say. Now he's found neutral there, will be able to get that out of the way. Meanwhile, that whole complex is operating under double yellow flags. So anybody else coming along will have to lift off. And he'll freewheel down. That is the pit lane exit. He can freewheel then. If he turns it left, the marshals can clear the car. And obviously it's not too long a walk for him then back to the pits. He'll have to jump into the spare car.
Well, you saw the Prost going out earlier as you watched Mika Häkkinen in the McLaren Mercedes. That Prost has had a recurrence of the gearbox problems that struck it in testing prior to the Australian Grand Prix and in the Australian Grand Prix itself. And neither of them have done particularly well because of that. Olivier Panis was running fourth yesterday, but he's down in eighth position this morning. And Jarno Trulli, that we've seen go round, is 12th fastest. The significant thing to me this morning, particularly, was how well the Benettons have been going, with Fisik Keller in fourth position and Alexander Wurz. And this will be only his fifth Grand Prix, sixth fastest. The Austrian, who in effect has replaced his great countryman, Gerhard Berger, who is here, and you've been seeing a lot of him.
Yes, Gerhard, we've been out on the track having a look and comparing notes and watching the cars and talking about the drivers, talking about old times. As you see, Rosset now lost the back end, pretty much on the way into the corner, just progressively broke away, and obviously it caught him a little bit by surprise. He didn't get the opposite lock-in, he didn't turn into the slide early enough or quickly enough, and there you see him jogging back to the pits, and it's way too warm a day to jog back to the pits here, and you're breathing so heavily inside that crash helmet and you feel terrible when you get back. Anyway, Rosset will have to take a break while they prepare his T car, and we will do the same.
Part whose birthday it was yesterday, out on the track, the man who finished second in Australia, second fastest in the McLaren Mercedes today. This is what the circuit looks like from his point of view.
And this is where he's losing out to Häkkinen, taking a lot of curb there. Of course, this is his out lap. He's not on a hot one. He's building up to that. But through this section, Hakkinen's got two or three tens on him. I know Dave has been looking at the line, looking at the computer traces and trying to understand how Häkkinen just gets on the throttle a little bit earlier than him. And then through here, Mergulo, and into the end of the lap, Junkau. David is taking time back again from Mika Häkkinen. That's why there's ended up being about a tenth between them. David said, I'm going to struggle to get to beat him to pole today. I said to him, if you can hang a perfect lap together, I think you'll be on pole position. And he now approaches the line to start that first lap. Remember, he spun off this morning on his last lap, so his confidence will need a little bit of a build-up. He needs to put one in the bank on this, and he's understeering very wide. That's a terrible start to the lap, David.
Well, this circuit, like all of them, is split up into three sectors, and it was on the second sector today that all the other cars were losing time to the McLarens and that Coulthard was losing time to Häkkinen.
And that's why he ran wide. He locked the left front on the way in, the unloaded left front wheel locked, and he ran wide into the corner and pretty much blew it.
Meantime, Olivier Panis has gone fastest in the Prost. His time is 6 tenths of a second slower than he was this morning. So we haven't yet had anybody this afternoon go quicker than they went this morning.
And he's lost the back end there into Pinarino. Terrible lap for David. He'll carry on. He knows this won't really do him any good this afternoon, but he may as well learn everything he can about the track. And again, the curbs are not too bumpy there. And now you have to bring the car over to the right. It's very bumpy, really, in the bottom of this Mergulo corner, and that's why Villeneuve and Trulli went off just there this morning and hit the wall very hard. David getting on the power. Now you can see it heading up, and you really appear to be looking at the sky, and it's quite difficult to place the car through to the end of the lap. Now sweeping down, he'll bring it over to the barrier on the left-hand side, and bang, here comes the line. What kind of time is it?
Well, he's going to go fastest, no doubt about that. And indeed he has, a second faster than Olivier Panis. There's Häkkinen watching his teammate, David Coulthard. 1 minute 18.769, 1.2 seconds slower than he went this morning. So obviously he's got a lot left.
The track is very, very slippery. Coulthard was struggling on at least four of the corners. He's still attacking the in-lap to see if he can find out where the new level of grip is, but he was really fighting that car. It's often a shock. You've had 2 hours since the morning session. The track temperature goes up. Breakdown vehicles, all kinds of vehicles take to the racetrack, and dust gets spread around. and suddenly you appear to have a different car on a different track, and you, where the car was good 2 hours ago, you're fighting it. And David has to learn where the new level of grip is, because that first lap of his had way too many mistakes.
So, Coulthard round the duck, Bill, the hairpin there, dropping downhill. Now he goes down to turn 12, and this is where the track starts to climb. Look at the angle of the car. He comes up towards the highest part of the circuit as he goes round the Junkow, turn 14. There's the entrance to the pit lane, and Coulthard dives into it, not happy with that lap at all. And the wheel covers will see. Tyre covers will soon be coming off Mikko's McLaren, and he will roll out onto the track. And with 13 minutes gone, 43 minutes to go, Coulthard is way fastest ahead of Panis. Damon Hill is up into third position, and Damon Hill's time is 0.6 seconds slower than he was this morning. So we're getting a pretty consistent pattern now, as Heinz Harald Frentzen, the man who got closest to the McLarens in his Williams Mechachrome in the new livery for 1998, goes out onto the circuit, followed by one of the Benettons. I didn't see whether it was Alexander Wurz or Fisichella. We'll soon spot him. And Frentzen goes down now towards turn four. He's doing about 170 miles an hour as he approaches the left-hander, backs off hard. This is where he starts to climb again, climbing out of turn four in fifth gear, up into sixth gear, up into the horseshoe.
Yes, it doesn't show up on the TV, but the horseshoe you're talking about is actually a blind crest, the second part of it. You really have to commit the car and really take a second guess as to whether you've got enough room on the exit, because by the time you can see the exit of that corner, it's just too late. As Häkkinen takes to the racetrack for his outlap, and I would think he'll be quite careful through the first half of that, just building up, gently building up the heat into the tyres, and getting a feel for the racetrack, and then attacking the last part of the lap, taking as little as he can out of the newness, the freshness of that Bridgestone compound that gives him the extra grip. As Johnny Herbert down into turn one locks his brakes again, he has had a weekend from hell. His car was failing him. He never completed a lap yesterday. Today he went barreling into the wall with the throttle stuck open. He must feel, what have I got to do this weekend? I just can't seem to get up and running and get some smooth lappery done. And Johnny's wheels were locked there very badly, as you saw. He's got a bit of smoke trailing out of the back. Now he's full opposite lock. That's the difficult section we've been talking about, where you've really got to get the car into the apex. You've got to attack the racetrack, but you must be smooth at the same time.
And you see that Johnny has got the mini wings on the pods that Tyrrell pioneered last year. And here he is, full lock. You can see how twitchy the cars are. They're narrower cars, they're narrower tyres. They've got grooves in the front, grooves at the back. It's a very, very bumpy circuit.
Colin McRae would have been proud of that recovery from Johnny Herbert there with full opposite lock.
And now it's still no change. We're still waiting for Häkkinen to go out. Significantly, of course, we're still waiting for Michael Schumacher to go out. Johnny Herbert's just gone ninth fastest, 2.5 seconds slower than Coulthard.
Yes, and you saw Johnny locking his brakes yet again. This is the spare car, remember. He'll have to reset the brake balance. It looks like he's got way too much bias to the front, and he'll have to pull that back a bit as we see Häkkinen on a hot lap.
Yeah, and I'm afraid Martin and I are labouring under a disadvantage at the moment. We're not going to be able to give you our astoundingly accurate predictions of lap times, because we're not getting any of the different sector times that we're talking about so much. So we have to wait until the end of the lap before we see whether the driver we're watching has gone faster or not. Mika Häkkinen is really, really relaxed these days. He's been with McLaren since 1993. He's very much liked by the team. He's got a fabulous motor car, and he's making maximum use of it.
Well, Alexander Wurz has gone fastest in the Benetton Playlife, but I think Häkkinen will probably take that away from him right now. Let's see what the computer says for the final time. A 17-2, stunning lap, fastest lap of the weekend already for Mika Häkkinen, just 1.2 seconds away from last year's pole. So just remind us, Murray, about who was on this yellow flag infringement this morning. because Hakkinen was one of them, wasn't he?
Yes, he was. So it's Mika Hakkinen, Eddie Irvine, Damon Hill, Alexander Foote. So to the two top fastest men at the moment, maybe losing their fastest time. Olivier Panis, that doesn't affect him too much at the moment. And Pedro Diniz, who is well down the pecking order. Indeed, he hasn't done a full lap. But Mika Hakkinen's gone faster this afternoon than he did this morning. But the first man to do that was Alexander Wurz, who knocked 0.6 seconds off this morning's time. Now, this young man is a real find, Martin.
He did a great job, of course, when he stood in for Gerhard Berger last year when Berger was sick, finishing on the podium at the British Grand Prix and pretty much humbling John Alesi. Without really any previous record to suggest he would have that kind of speed and commitment and experience, really. So, you know, it's not surprising us too much given last year's form, but he did an appalling job in Melbourne. But he seems to have settled in very well here on the Interlagos circuit, which really does reward you if you attack the racetrack.
And it's his first time here, second fastest. Not gone out yet. Pedro Diniz in the arrows, and we're 13 minutes into the session. Villeneuve has not gone out. And yes, he has, because Villeneuve is on the track now, and there is the living proof. Jacques Villeneuve, the world champion of 1997. The best he could do this morning was 11th fastest, because he had that colossal off approaching turn 12 at about 150 miles an hour when he started to go off, and he wiped the side off the Williams, as a result of which he's had to have the spare car adjusted for him, and he's out in that now.
You can see the fuel flap there has detached itself on Villeneuve's car. That won't bother him at all, but you'll see it as he builds up speed, waving around on the side of his car there, and he's going to lose it. Yeah, he's kept the engine running, no problem, and that won't do his Goodyear's a lot of good. But anyway, nice display there, Jacques. Frustrating day for him, obviously not comfortable with the setup of that car. Frank Williams looking seriously unimpressed.
Yeah, and an interesting thing as you watch a replay of Villeneuve spinning on full lock is that Frentzen was better than him in Australia, the man who was very much second in the Williams team, and of course he was better than him today. And down there in the pit lane, James Allen's got some news about the tyres. What is it, James?
Well, Murray, we've had a chance now to look at what everyone's running, and certainly all the Goodyear runners are on soft tyres. There's not a huge difference here between the soft and the hard compound tyres, but certainly the awful lot better performance, a lot better consistency than we had in Melbourne. Michael Schumacher, interestingly, did 28 laps yesterday, a very long run on one set of tyres, and his best lap came on his 23rd lap. So obviously the consistency has been greatly improved. All the Bridgestone runners are using harder tyres. We're looking at four runs per car, so a lot of action for the rest of the afternoon. And it looks like we're heading for a one-stop race, Murray. That's my conclusion from this.
Well, 23 minutes gone now, coming up towards half-time as we watch Ralf Schumacher in the Jordan Mugen, and he is down in 14th position at the moment, Damon Hill.
Damon will be watching this closely. He was out-qualified by Ralf in Melbourne and certainly won't want to be out-qualified again here. Remember, Damon went very well here last year in the Arrows, and that's not the kind of... He doesn't need Ralf appearing to be faster than him. It's very bad for his reputation in that respect. And Ralf does appear to like this track.
36 minutes to go. Mika Hakkinen is fastest. Faster than yesterday and this morning. A second faster than Alexander Wurz in the Benetton. Fisichella in the second Benetton is third fastest. That's significant. Michael Schumacher is fourth fastest. Slightly closer to the McLarens than he was this morning, but 1.5 seconds off the pace. David Coulthard, after that tardy lap of his, is down in fifth position. Heinz-Harald Frentzen is in sixth position.
Good lap there from Ralf, moving him up to fourth place, just ahead of his brother Michael, 0.03 seconds faster than his big brother, and second row of the grid at the moment for Ralf Schumacher.
Yes, very good indeed, too, ahead of brother Michael, as you say. And the Jordan Mugen Honda is looking good, with the news that Honda are going to be coming back into racing, which may or may not be good for Eddie Jordan. He's hoping it'll be good news for him in terms of getting a Honda engine.
Well, the two of our two top Brits, really, under pressure now, because Hakkinen's put in a stunning 17-2, which will leave David Coulthard thinking, I've got a lot of work to do now to beat that, even with a stunning lap of my own this afternoon. And Hill, a full 1.2 seconds slower than young Ralph.
But let's remind ourselves that Mika Häkkinen may be denied that time, in which case David Coulthard, who was only 1/10 of a second slower than him this morning, could move ahead and take pole position as we ride in the Arrows.
Down to turn four. He'll break about 100 metres before the corner, down into third. But notice the track falls away from you here. It's quite a tricky corner, actually. You have to wait much longer before you get on the throttle than you ever want to. There's a bump through here. You have to be careful you don't bottom out with the suspension. Into Ferradura, blind on the entry. This is the part I was telling you about. Now you can't see the exit until you pop over the top, and he's off.
It's Deniz. It's Pedro Deniz has gone off. He's gone into the... It's not gravel. It's a man-made aggregate, but it slowed him down.
He's out of there. He's going to get out of that.
Interesting this morning, Martin, that there's a lot of tarmac runoff, and as you know, they're talking about getting rid of gravel traps and letting tarmac do what it used to do, and it seemed by and large to be working very well this morning.
Well, there's a big chunk gone in at Silverstone at Club Corner, which is great as long as the wheels are still on the car to slow you down if you're trundling along on your chassis. And there we see Deniz. It's exactly the point I was telling you about. You can't see the exit until you're over the top, then it's too late. A trip through the scenery, he kept the engine running, a little bit of power, and out through to the grass. The underneath of that car will look a mess, and they will have to repaint it when it gets back to England.
And he was the last man to complete, or will be the last man to complete, a full lap. Everybody else has gone out. There's a gap of 5.2 seconds between the fastest and the slowest at the present moment. Mika Häkkinen is fastest. Tora Takagi, the Japanese driver in the Tyrrell, is slowest, 5 seconds off the pace. Rosset is in 20th position. And Mika Salo, that we've seen going round in the Arrows, is 19th. As his teammate Pedro Deniz comes into the pit lane, and you can see the white line there, that's where they have to come down to 50 miles an hour on the qualifying day and 75 miles an hour in the race. In the background you see part of, a very, very small part of Sao Paulo, and here is Damon Hill, and he at the present moment is 12th fastest in the Arrows Mugello. Sadly, no sector times, but he's coming up towards the end of the lap now as he goes across the start and finish grid. I'm watching his position on the readout in front of me. And he has not improved. Yes, he has. He moves up into ninth place. 1 minute 19.64, that's 2.35 seconds slower than Mika Häkkinen, who is a second faster than Wurz in the Benetton, who is second fastest.
Still 9/10 slower than Ralph, and Damon will be back in the pit and looking at Ralph's setup, because Ralph clearly has either a quicker style or more likely a quicker setup. As we see Häkkinen taking to the track, I have to say that 17.2 looked pretty untroubled. I wouldn't be at all surprised he can't equal that or beat it.
David Coulthard rolls out of the pit lane onto the second part of the Senna S. Keeps bearing left, accelerates away.
That's Coulthard now joining. You have to watch for the blue flag here because you can't see the cars coming around the track. It's very easy to drive straight into the side of a car already on a hot lap. It's a very difficult pit exit here. Coulthard is on his way. And, of course, we already saw Häkkinen further around the track too. There's the Williams. They have no spare car. That's running wide. He's lost time already. Frentzen there. And there's no spare car for Williams because we all have stuck it in the hedge this morning.
Well, in case you've just joined us, we had the very significant news just as qualifying was beginning that several drivers may lose their fastest lap in this qualifying period on account of passing out of the yellows this morning. And significantly, those drivers include Mika Häkkinen, Eddie Irvine, Damon Hill, Alexander Wurz, Parnis and Pedro Deniz. We're watching Frentzen.
Pathetic lap from Frentzen here. He's all over the place. Locking wheels left, locking wheels right. Well, it's not going to get him anywhere this way.
30 minutes gone, 30 minutes to go. Mika Häkkinen is fastest by 1 second. Wurz is second, Benetton. Fisichella is third, Benetton. Ralph and Michael Schumacher, fourth and fifth. Ralph in the Jordan, faster than his double world champion brother Michael in the Ferrari. David Coulthard is in sixth position. Heinz Harald Frentzen that we're watching is seventh. Jarno Trulli in the Prost is eighth. Damon Hill is ninth. Rubens Barrichello is in tenth place. Frentzen moves up to third.
I was wrong. He didn't lock his brakes, but obviously was travelling fast when he did it. My apologies, Heinz Harald.
Now you know how I feel. So, we're watching the McLaren now with Mika Häkkinen still way ahead in terms of time. The only person I think is going to get near him in time, that's Häkkinen that we're watching, is David Coulthard. He is on the circuit at the present moment. Where he is in terms of segments, I can't tell you, because as I said, we're not getting that information, sadly, and it's of enormous benefit to us. But up into turn 14, the Jungkau, past the massive grandstand there, and up, climbing a bit more past the entrance to the pit lane into the last corner, turn 15, building up to 190 miles an hour. Over the line goes the McLaren Mercedes as Norbert Haug, who is the boss of the Mercedes competition department, watches 1:17.092, a fastest lap again for Mika Häkkinen, and that's only 1 second slower now than last year's pole position time.
Coulthard second on a 17.7, a much better lap from David, but still 0.75 seconds behind that stunner from Häkkinen. And we see Coulthard now, I'm sure this is his in-lap, down into turn four with the off-camber. And David, you need to push all the way home because you've got to find something. Häkkinen is not 0.75 seconds faster than you ran out. You've been just a tenth or two behind him. And clearly with the spin-off this morning and the poor first lap, David's having to find his way again, and his last two runs will be critical. Norbert Haug, the Mercedes-Benz Motorsport boss, will be pretty pleased. Another all-silver front row at the moment as Michael Schumacher is on his way. And I think that's put him up into third place, Murray. Yes, an 18.2, still 1.2 seconds off pole, but a second row position at the moment for Michael Schumacher in the Ferrari.
Exactly the same as Melbourne at the present moment. Häkkinen fastest, Coulthard second, Michael Schumacher on the second row of the grid in third place, and frankly I suspect that that's going to be as good as it gets. But 1.1 seconds off for Michael Schumacher is no mean achievement. He was 1.5 seconds off this morning. There is Jacques Villeneuve waiting to go out. He's only in 14th place at the moment. He's got to close a gap of 3 seconds between himself and Häkkinen. There are 27 minutes left. And so far, Ralf Schumacher has done 2 of the 4 outings that we're expecting him to do. He's done 6 laps. So has Trulli. So has Damon Hill. The man who's done the most laps, actually, is Tora Takagi, the Japanese driver in the Tyrrell. He's done 7 circuits. And there's Fisichella off. And this is how it happened.
That's the bumps in Megulu again. And it sends you slightly off to the right and immediately off the racetrack. He just made contact with the barriers. And they'll lift that car. They may have to red flag it, but there should be a little buggy coming across to lift that away. They did that with one of the cars this morning. If they can move it quickly enough, it may save the session. But of course, there'll be double waved yellows, men on the racetrack, slow down, and anybody, here comes the buggy. I wouldn't want to run into that.
Do you think it's very bright? I remember you nearly hit one in Japan, didn't you?
I missed one by a fraction, and unfortunately hit the marshal that was standing near it, and had a very nasty accident with him back in 94. But if you go underneath one of those things in a Formula One car, then I think you'll be pushing up daisies, unfortunately. Louise is down in the pits, and she has some news for us.
Yeah, there's loads of action happening out on the track. Jarno Trulli isn't taking any part in it, though. He's sat in the garage. He's been there for quite some time whilst the mechanics make some changes to the car. He's been there so long, he's actually nodded off in the car. The mechanics just had to wake him up to ask him a question. How do you fall asleep in the middle of a qualifying session? I don't know. Maybe you can answer that, Martin.
Well, you say that you were focusing on your quick lap and you were really getting your head and really imagining your ultimate pole position lap, but maybe he was asleep. I don't know.
Yeah, well, Nelson Piquet used to go to sleep regularly. But here's Johnny Herbert, and he needs to improve. As Martin said, he's had a dreadful weekend. Massive off this morning. He didn't get any laps at all in yesterday. Lost a whole day of setting the car up, and he's struggling. He was down in 21st place, but he's put in a searing lap now, and in one mighty bound, he has leapt free and up into 10th position. And he is 2.5 seconds off the pace But when I tell you that Michael Schumacher is 1.2 seconds off the pace, that puts things into perspective, and Johnny's undoubtedly going to go quicker. 25 minutes to go. The order still is Häkkinen, Coulthard, both of them in the McLaren Mercedes, on the front row of the grid. Second row of the grid, Michael Schumacher, Alexander Wurz. Three Bridgestone cars on the top four. Frentzen is in fifth position and Fisichella is in sixth place, but now he will be walking back to get into the spare.
Well, that's the new mature Johnny Herbert. He's doing a fantastic job at the moment. He's really got hold of that Sauber team. And he's had, he's really not got a clear lap in all weekend. And here he is, 2/10 ahead of Lacy, his teammate, already in the top 10 on the grid. As we watch them tinkering around with the Ferrari, Schumacher will have them change the ride height slightly, maybe lower the car to try to pick up a little bit more aerodynamic grip. But if you do that here, you have to watch those bumps in Mergulo, where we saw Fisichella going off, Villeneuve this morning, Trulli this morning. You really, if you adjust the car for one part of this racetrack, you really have to be careful it doesn't cause you a major problem in another. We're going to take a break.
Fine, completes a lap in the Ferrari. He started this lap 12th on the grid, and he has moved up to 8th position on the grid. He is 1.9, as near as makes no difference, 2 seconds slower than Mika Häkkinen and a second slower than his teammate Michael Schumacher. And we have 21 minutes of the qualifying session left.
That's an interesting shot. It appears as if his side pod is moving up and down, which would surprise me. Those kind of aerodynamic parts are not allowed to move. Either that or the camera's jiggling around a little bit. James is in the Ferrari garage at the moment.
That's right, Martin. Yes, Michael Schumacher has been struggling all weekend with understeer, the car pushing through the corner towards the outside, as we've been seeing. He's just changed the front wing on that. Tremendous amount more downforce. Obviously, he wants a better turn in. He wants the car to point itself towards the apex more readily when he turns the wheel, and he's hoping that this will give it to him. There's obviously no chance of catching the McLarens. Meanwhile, Jacques Villeneuve, of course, in the spare Williams. They don't have a spare car because he smashed it up this morning. He's just been tinkering with it all afternoon. He's just changed the rear wing. Again, more downforce at the back for Villeneuve. And of course, he always saves the best for last. So we'll be seeing something from him, I think, in a few minutes.
Yes, a lot to do for Villeneuve in 16th place at the moment. Frentzen in fifth, still a long way off the pace. And Michael does like a car really on the front end. He likes to have to wrestle it a little bit on the way in, but he likes the front to go exactly where he needs it, into the apex and under braking. And he's then prepared and able to cope with the back end sliding thereafter. Not many drivers are, as we watch Damon Hill climbing the hill. Just 20 minutes left of this session, and Damon, all you can do now is keep your foot flat to the floor, drive the smoothest line of least resistance, and see what the lap time comes up on your dashboard. And we'll get a readout anytime now, as you have done. It's a 19.7, it's a tenth slower, he's 9/10 behind Ralph. He will be angry. He's only got one run left.
Yes, Damon really needs to improve. The last thing he wants as a world champion of 1996 is to be shown the way home on the grid by his young, inexperienced teammate for the second race in succession at the beginning of the season. Damon Hill currently in 13th position, and the order is still Häkkinen, Coulthard. The gap between Coulthard, who is second, and Michael Schumacher, who is third, is about 7/10 of a second. But there's 6/10 of a second between Coulthard and Häkkinen. I remind you again, and I'm going to continue to do so, that Mika Häkkinen may lose his fastest time. I suspect that his second fastest time would still be quicker than David Coulthard's 1 minute 17.7, which would preserve the pole position that he's currently holding until the end of the session, when we will know what's happened. 18 minutes to go. Damon Hill coming through to complete another lap.
Yes, of course, Hakkinen's second fastest time is a 17.2, so he's still on pole position. And David Coulthard's got to find a full half second, and that's not easy. It doesn't sound much, a little more than the blink of an eye, but it's very difficult to find when you're already on the ragged edge.
Well, here's Michael Schumacher, double world champion. He voluntarily left Benetton because he wanted the challenge of helping Ferrari to improve. Well, he has helped them enormously, but not enough. This is the season, I said, where they're looking for real success. And it looks at the present moment as though it's going to be denied them unless they can close up very dramatically indeed on McLaren. He's third fastest, 1.1 seconds slower as he comes across the grid to complete the lap.
Yes, and this will be the start of his fastest lap, I believe. He's put the extra wing on, and he will lose out down that straight. It means the car will go more slowly, but in the corners he should find some time. First section is not going to be much in it. There's more straight than corners, and that critical midsection he can really attack and hope to come up with a better lap time. He's a half a second to get up onto the front row at the moment to beat David Coulthard. And now we're heading into that section towards the horseshoe at the end of this short straight, and this is where Michael really wants to take the dividends and the bonuses out of the extra downforce he's carried so far through the lap. And if he can keep it nice and neat and tidy, no wheels locking, nice line, power on, just a little bit of oversteer on the way through. That's running wider than he would want, I'm sure. But good drive out. And again, don't lock your wheels. He's taking nice speed and a little bit of correction there, a little bit of oversteer, the back end sliding as he goes in. Through Mergulo, takes a tight line in actually, and that's leaving him wide on the exit. He'll have to take a breather on the throttle. Now smooth on the way in, bury the throttle early. Yeah, nice run up the hill. I don't know whether it's enough to get on the front row, and we've got no other kind of computer data to confirm that. So we can sit like Michael and just watch the computer screen for the final lap time.
P3, it says there, and that's the continuing position. Michael Schumacher is still at 1.1 seconds off pole position, and he's about 6/10 of a second off the front row of the grid. And there's the Williams.
Yes, just 3/100 of a second slower for Michael. Obviously, the trade-off of slower down the straight, quicker through the corners, left him with pretty much the same lap time. And it's absolutely amazing how often that happens on all circuits around the world.
Now, here's Frentzen. Now, Alexander Wurz is faster than he is. New boy, Alexander Wurz. Michael Schumacher is faster than he is. And really, we're thinking now about who's going to be third on the grid rather than who's going to be first and second. There's very little doubt that the McLaren Mercedes are going to be there. Which order they're going to be in remains to be seen. There are still 15 minutes to go. So what Hightower Frentzen is trying to do is to take fourth position away from Wurz, or even third position away from Michael Schumacher. And if he improves his time by just 1/10 of a second, he will move up onto the second row of the grid. The order still with 15 minutes to go. Häkkinen, Coulthard, Michael Schumacher, Wurz, Frentzen, Fisichella, Ralf Schumacher, Trulli, 9th is Olivier Panis, 10th is Eddie Irvine. Johnny Herbert is 12th, Damon Hill is languishing in 13th position. And Pedro Diniz, for the record, has now completed a lap, and everybody of the 22 starters is inside the 107% limit.
Well, as we see the covers coming off of Coulthard's tyres for his third run, James is in the pits. James, yes. What can you tell us?
He's just driven past me, Martin, and out there with very hopeful eyes trying to do something about his teammate, Mika Häkkinen. But let me tell you, he's really had his head down for the last 5 minutes at least. He's been studying the telemetry data, looking at an overlay of Mika Häkkinen's best lap and his own best lap, trying to figure out where Häkkinen's making up this time. And he really has been studying hard. He's got a steely look in his eyes. And you remember, he's just got to go out there now and try and beat Häkkinen's second fastest time.
Yes, it seems to me that Häkkinen has just pulled an ace out. He's been saving something all through the practice run, because he's not had this kind of advantage over David. And it will have rattled David's cage somewhat. And we'll see now if he can keep his head together under pressure. This is where he spun off this morning. This is his out lap, remember. Bring it in. I know he's had a lot of understeer through this corner. Touch the curb, over the top, and then into the technical section. A nice onboard shot. David going very, very slowly. The reason for that is there's a car ahead of him. He's making himself some space. He doesn't want to catch that car. The McLarens have got so much speed. He wants to be sure he's not going to catch that slower car on the hot lap, which he's building up to. Just three corners to go.
Well, let's remind ourselves, like it or not, that Häkkinen and Coulthard made an arrangement in Australia that whoever got to the first corner first would win the race, provided they both finished in first and second places. Well, Coulthard expected to get to that first corner first because he's a super starter normally, but he didn't. So he's going to be all the more determined to start in pole position tomorrow for the Brazilian Grand Prix.
David braking there at 50 metres before the corner at 190 miles an hour. Think about that. He says nobody's braking later than me there. And that certainly was an awful lot smoother. than the first run that he did, moving away from the side of the track a little bit where it's dirty and back onto line now for turn four. Careful not to get on the power too early, David. Use the curb, no problem, plenty of grip out there. Nasty bump here, but his car will ride it nicely into Ferradura. He'll have a little twitch here. This is where he spun off. He's got a good line. Take the curb on the inside, hard on the gas, yes. Now, no locking of brakes, it's good. Plenty of curb, lost the back end, half a tenth gone there, but it's still in play. There's the grip right there, right in the middle of that corner, and it catapults you out. He's taking a wider line in there and didn't really quite get into the apex. We've got a big fly squashed on our screen. Down through Mayer, got to listen to the throttle coming on and off. Nicely done. Now the back end of the car will wander around in there. You can see him correcting it. Hard on the power now. Hey, looks a good clean lap. I wonder if this is not fast enough. I wonder if he's got the speed. But here he comes, cutting the corner. He takes a tighter line through there than some. In towards the barrier now. And he just wished that line would hurry up and arrive. Look at the computer on your screen. And what do we have?
David Coulthard is still in second position. He's just gone round 1:17.8, which is 1/10 of a second slower than he went before. And he's now done 8 of the 12 laps. He's got one run left. There are 11 minutes of the session left. It's still Häkkinen and Coulthard, a second faster than everybody else, Mika Häkkinen. Michael Schumacher is still third. Wurz is still fourth. Ahead of Frentzen, fifth. Fisichella, sixth. Ralf Schumacher, seventh. Eddie Irvine, eighth. Jarno Trulli, ninth. And Olivier Panis, tenth.
Well, David's going to just have to throw caution to the wind and go for it. He is not basically fast enough to take away that pole position. Häkkinen is on pole as far as I can see. David's just got a glance over his shoulder at the two Benettons and Michael Schumacher, but I think he should be reasonably safe on the front row, but that's going to be very frustrating. And I can tell you, when David would have looked at his computer screen, it would have said 1:17.8 and his heart would have sunk.
And I wonder how Alexander Wurz is feeling as we look at the Benetton people in the pit lane. And now Johnny Herbert, with smoke coming from the Petronas Ferrari-based engine behind him. Johnny Herbert tried to improve on 13th position as he comes up and dives inside Ricardo Rosset, who moves over in the Tyrrell and lets him through. Johnny Herbert down in 13th position, 2.5 seconds off the pace. 10 minutes to go in the qualifying session for tomorrow's Brazilian Grand Prix here at Interlagos. Out of the Jungkau, up to turn 15, and no, into the pit lane goes Johnny Herbert. Well, he's now done, he will have done 9 laps, so he's just going to have an out lap, a quick lap, and an in lap to improve. Feel very, very sorry for him, because as Martin said, he's right on top of the Sauber team and drove an absolutely superb race in Melbourne. David Coulthard, well, he's done 9 laps. Mika Häkkinen's only done 6. Mika's got 2 runs left if he's got time to make them.
The black box they've just put down in front of David is not a portable telephone to ring his mum on and talk about this. They'll be up in Twynham, up in Scotland, watching the qualifying, I'm sure, the Coulthard family. But it's a remote control for the TV screen so that he can look through the data, look through the times of all of the drivers. But like us up here in the commentary box and all of the pit lane, all of the teams, all of the drivers, there's no computer data today to let them know which section of the racetrack they're losing out on. And that will add frustration to David's problems, which is why he had to spend so long looking at data's own McLaren print, McLaren's own data, sorry, printed out on a piece of paper in the cockpit.
Now, you saw Fisichella there, who went off getting into the spare Benetton. Now you're looking at Damon Hill. Now the gap between Damon, who is 14th, and his young teammate Ralf Schumacher is seventh, is 9/10 of a second. So to get ahead of Schumacher, who is currently Ralf Schumacher, I'm talking about, 7th on the grid, Damon has got to make a big, big improvement in his lap time. He's now completed 10 laps, so he's got this one and the in-lap. He's got to do it on this lap. Damon Hill, who last year drove for Arrows after having lost his drive when he became world champion for Williams in 1996, going for it in the Gary Anderson-designed Jordan Mugen. This has to be his quick lap.
And Damon is not really well known for that do-or-die last-minute qualifying effort. He's a very smooth driver, which makes him a very good race driver. And of course, he has been on pole several times, and he is a very fast driver, of course, but he's not famous for that total maximum attack final qualifying effort. And here he's running a little bit wide there. A puff of smoke coming out as he buried the throttle, but hopefully Damon could improve. He will be seriously unhappy if he ends up 14th on the grid. Did a wonderful lap time around Barcelona last week during testing. It looks pretty sensible lap up to this point.
Before we get the avalanche of letters, he's been on pole 21 times in his career.
I did say several.
Well, is he going to improve on 14th? We're going to find out very soon now. Ex-world champion Damon Hill, you can see the grid lines painted on the tarmac, up out of the dip, over the line, and into the Senna S, and he's up to ninth position, but he's still slower than Ralf Schumacher. 1.6 seconds off the pace, Ralf Schumacher. 1.9 seconds off the pace, Damon Hill.
Yes, that's a bittersweet lap for Damon. At least he's in the top 10. He'll feel a lot happier about that if he can stay there, of course. The two guys behind him, Trulian Panis in the Prost Peugeot, are just a few hundredths of a second slower than him with laps remaining. But Damon is fully committed now. He's done all of his runs, and he's once again going to start behind Ralf. So, as I say, it's a very bittersweet lap, that.
Well, it's 6 minutes to go now. I've said this before and been proved wrong, but I think nothing now can stop the two McLarens from being on the front row of the grid. Mika Häkkinen is in pole position at the present moment. He's got five laps in which to improve if he wants to. David Coulthard is in second place, and there is Mika Häkkinen out on the track. David Coulthard's just got three laps. Michael Schumacher in the Ferrari will be looking for a consistent run tomorrow. He still hasn't got any world championship points, don't forget. Alexander Wurz is in fourth place. That's Esteban Tuero, the 19-year-old Argentine driver in the Minardi Ford, or at least out of the Minardi Ford, making sure that his steering wheel is on so that the car can be removed if necessary.
Häkkinen is on the racetrack, as we can see, but that's an interesting problem the stewards have got with that Minardi on the start-finish line. It's a very difficult area to recover a car from. Häkkinen making way there for the other drivers coming through. I wonder if he's coming in the pits, if the team have told him there may well be a red... They've probably told him, hang on a bit, there may be a red flag situation, in which case he'll get this lap back. Because the stewards really got to decide, are they comfortable with that Minardi stuck on the side of the racetrack? There's no real gap in the pit wall to clear the car away. And you can see Mika really... No, he's gone in the pit lane himself. So, of course, he's under this problem with waved yellow flags, Marius. If he comes barreling past the pits, he could find himself disqualified. So a smart move there by the team. They think he's on pole position anyway, as we do, and they don't want to risk infringing a yellow flag penalty again. I'd like to see what they're actually doing about Tuero's Minardi on the start finish straight.
Well, Olivier Panis doesn't care. He's out trying to improve on his eighth position. And it's worth reminding everybody again that Mika Häkkinen may lose that 1:17.09.2 lap that he's done, the fastest lap, because of passing under yellows this morning. One of six drivers potentially to be penalised. If he does, David Coulthard might move up into pole position.
Well, Panis has just set the eighth fastest time under the yellow flags. You saw him just passing. So and he's one of those guys already under notification of not lifting off this morning. And the stewards will... They're stationary yellow flags warning that the car's there. So clearly they've decided not to red flag the session. They think the car is far enough off the racing line, away from the braking areas, that it's not a serious issue.
Just under 4 minutes, as you've seen, and Panis has got the mini wings on the Prost, as the Saubers have as well. David Coulthard has got just about 3.5 minutes left to get out and do his out lap, and then a quick lap in the hope of improving by over 6 tenths of a second and taking pole from Häkkinen, as Eddie Irvine goes out to try and improve on sixth position. In fact, he's in sixth place now. He's displaced Fisichella and Ralf Schumacher. So Eddie Irvine has done extremely well. The gap between himself and the great Michael Schumacher is only 0.2 seconds. Well done, Eddie Irvine.
That's a good effort from Irvine. As I said yesterday when we were out watching him, he was completely at sea, all over the place, overdriving the car. He's clearly got the car much more to his liking. Sixth place for Eddie. Tremendous qualifying effort that. That was a do or die run. Just 0.2 behind Michael, as you rightly say. There's Michael. There's only 2 or 3 minutes left. He's going to have to get out of the pit lane pretty soon if he wants to get a final run in. 2:50 to be precise.
And you saw Alexander Wurz's car being frantically pushed down the pit lane by the Benetton mechanics. He's fourth fastest, faster than Fisichella. That's a very considerable achievement. And we now have 2.5 minutes left as Eddie Irvine comes in, and I have little doubt Michael Schumacher goes out. And now we are going to see some real action, because Michael has got 3 laps left. And there is Frentzen.
We've got Eddie Jordan down here asking the guys on the gantry holding the yellow flags, and now we've got Benetton representatives coming along saying, are you going to pull that flag in? Because if you don't pull that flag in, our guys can't race for a lap time. And they're just looking up and saying, what are you doing? Are you holding that yellow flag out there, or are you going to pull it in now that all the drivers are aware that there's a stationary car just after the start finish line? But this is not slowing down the Williams. The Williams is very much on it. It's Frentzen, yes, crossing the line.
And Frentzen moves up to third position, ahead of Michael Schumacher. It's Häkkinen, Coulthard, Frentzen. The gap is 1 second, just a few thousandths over a second. But Frentzen has got 0.1 seconds faster than Michael Schumacher in the battle to get onto the second row behind the two McLarens. And here, coming towards us, is Alexander Wurz. You saw his car being pushed out. It's now 1:15 to go. And David Coulthard.
Well, there's no point in going out.
David's had it. He can't get round.
Can't get round in time
to start another lap.
Right.
So unless Mika Häkkinen loses his fastest lap, and David Coulthard's fastest lap was close enough to Häkkinen's second fastest lap, are you still with me? It means that Häkkinen will be in pole position for the second race in succession this year, as Michael Schumacher comes through to complete the lap. Over the line he goes.
That was Schumacher's outlap, so we now know he is in play. He got through before the checkered flags came out. 38 seconds to run. It doesn't matter. He can still pass the checkered and register a time. David Coulthard will be watching this with great interest. Michael Schumacher has to get on it. The track looks relatively clear ahead of him as he goes through turn four.
And how I miss those sector times. Behind him is Jean Alesi, down in 16th place. He was hoping to do a lot better than that in the Sauber. And David Coulthard just had to give it best. There's no point in going out. Michael Schumacher is about halfway round the lap now and into the twisty section where he was losing time quite seriously to the McLarens this morning. They are so nimble and so powerful. And there is the checkered flag. This is going to be the last lap that Michael Schumacher does out of the duck bill, down to the Mergulo, turn 11, down still to turn 12. Now he starts to climb up to the Yunkao, and he's got to improve his time by 0.1 seconds to regain that third position from Heinz Harald Frentzen. Over the grid, into the last turn, and Michael Schumacher crosses the line and stays in the fourth position.
It was an 18.5, so 0.3 slower from Schumacher, and Frentzen stays in third, Schumacher fourth. Wurz went a slightly faster, stays in fifth. Irvine, we've already said, strong performance in sixth. Fisichella, and Ralf Schumacher, Olivier Panis, the reigning world champion, Jacques Villeneuve.
What about
in
that?
10th
place. Position. Jacques Villeneuve, after going off this morning and taking large lumps off the car, the world champion is starting 10th, 1.7 seconds slower than the very happy Mika Häkkinen. There he is, pole position for the second race in succession. Now, I mustn't talk about team orders, but if Mika Häkkinen is starting in pole position and gets into the first corner first, I think it would be very difficult for David Coulthard to pass him.
Well, Häkkinen does appear to have the speed advantage. He has been a few tenths quicker than David through every session, basically. But David's a strong race driver, and he can put him under pressure. There's many factors to the race, of course. The pit stops, the in-laps, the out-laps, the whole strategy. And getting one fast lap is different to getting 72 fast laps out of your car. So it's not all over for David, but Mika is looking very, very strong, isn't he?
22 drivers will start tomorrow as Mika Häkkinen embraces Mercedes boss Norbert Haug. And the top man on the grid tomorrow is the man you're looking at, Finland's Mika Häkkinen, who leads the World Championship. His teammate David Coulthard starts alongside him on the front row of the grid, unless there's a sensational upset over this lost fast.